Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for making the effort to stay around, or some not, on a Friday afternoon. I'm conscious there's a football match happening relatively soon, and Eric is anxious to get there, so we'll keep moving. We're going to shift gears significantly now from real hard science into a very clinical approach to things, and hopefully try to marry the two. But I'm very much taking this from a clinician's and a clinical perspective. And one thing that I think as a clinician, whenever we have a patient or an injured athlete in front of us, that we always want to begin with the end in mind. And I think that just as it's a habit of highly successful people, it's a habit of highly successful clinicians, and we need to know what it is that the muscle is going to be required to do when you return to sport. And ultimately, when we're trying to maximise healing, we always have one eye on the task for which that muscle will have to return to. So when we are talking about facilitating or maximising healing, what do we really mean by healing? Because initially, I guess, like me, your thought was, well, we're talking about tissue healing. We're talking about re-establishing the great architectural form that we've seen in many of those images there. But I would contend that ultimately the healing is not just about restoration of architecture, but it's also restoration of function, and that will and that if we're talking about healing, we're really talking about the overlay of both of those things that ultimately is the restoration of return to sport or function. So when we talk about healing, I think we want to think not just in terms of restoring the architectural appearance of the muscle, but also the function of that muscle and how that the injured muscle is reintegrated into function again. And so can we promote healing? Can we promote effective healing and influence some of these processes that have been so well described by Abigail? And are there things that we can do by rehabilitation and through exercise that can facilitate and get a better outcome? Well, I think the first question we have to ask ourselves as clinicians is, well, how are we doing? What do the stats tell us about how we're doing in rehab? And I'm not going to talk too much about this because Eric's going to talk about recurrence. But if we look at this work that done while Eric was in Qatar, Baron Log Vankenstein, and looking at recurrence rates of hamstring injuries, if we look here at the recurrence rates over time, and you'll see the cumulative proportion of re-injury and the time from return to sport until re-injury, what we see is that there were two of these re-injuries were in different muscles. We'll see that two of them were in the same muscle, but that 79 or almost 80% of the re-injuries happened at the same location. So there's perhaps something about that specific location of the injury that means that either structurally or functionally, it wasn't prepared for the forces that were going to be applied to it. And that, interestingly, you see that 50% of the re-injuries happen within 25 days after return to sport. So most injuries are happening just after return to sport, and they're tending to happen at the same location of the index injury. And so I would suggest perhaps, or hopefully, we can do better, and that's really what a symposium like this is about. And so if we think about mechanical stimulus for muscle repair, well, we've seen many sessions over the last few days, and again there will be some tomorrow, on the effects of different exercise types on muscle regeneration and muscle hypertrophy and different training effects. Those pathways by which we stimulate the training effects hold fast when we come to repair, and we're really trying to then look at the mechanical forces and how they can regulate some of those biological, chemical, and genetic factors. And I'm not a basic scientist, so questions in that regard, Abigail is definitely much better prepared too. But I would very clearly say, and this is an important factor in terms of our rehabilitation and management of injury, is that movement and mechanical stimulus is by far more effective than pharmacological and cellular therapies. And the idea of injecting something into a muscle to make it heal better, I would suggest is relatively unfounded. However, applying the right type of mechanical stimulus is where we want to really be going. And how does mechanical stimulus or mechanical load stimulate adaptation? Well, we know that by adding the mechanical stimulus, we will apply forces to those tissues, that we will get cellular forces, and ultimately there will be a molecular response. The nature of those forces will be determined by the mechanical properties of the the tissues and the mechanical properties of the cells. And we've seen in the previous speaker some of those mechanical properties and how they're influenced by injury. And then we know that by applying the mechanical load to the tissues and to the cellular, to the cells, that we will get some cytoskeletal rearrangement, and ultimately that extracellular matrix will be either synthesized, or we'll get some degradation depending on the nature, the intensity and the volume of the load that we apply to those tissues. So we want to try to maximize that adaptation, and we're all familiar with the good old historical studies, and it was a nice, really nice session yesterday afternoon looking at muscle, Jeff Goldspink was quoted at that stage, and we're all familiar with the landmark work that was done there, but you know, things haven't really changed in terms of the fundamental, real basic big rocks of how muscle adapts to loading. And so we know the mechanisms, our understanding has increased, but certainly we know that muscle will change in terms of its physiological cross-sectional area. We also know that we'll see changes in fascicle length, and I see Anthony Blazevic, who had a great presentation yesterday talking about some of these adaptations. And then thirdly, we'll see that there'll be changes and increases in muscle force, and that these may not just be due to morphological or architectural changes, but they may be due to some other neurological or neuromuscular adaptations. And these are the three primary ways in which muscle will ultimately adapt to loading. So it's in rehabilitation, it's for us to adapt and to modify that loading to maximize these different types of adaptation and how that relates to healing and to re-injury. And we have to have a really good, sound understanding of those basic relationships of the force length curve and the force velocity curves, both in the concentric and eccentric directions. And we recognize that muscle architecture, and I did like the point that was made yesterday, it used to be so simple, but we realized that nothing's just ever black and white. But we do recognize that architecture does influence function, and that Richard Leber's work back in, and Leber and Frieden's work back in the early 90s and late 80s, we recognize that we see this trend towards where if I have longer fibers and a larger physiological cross-sectional area, that I will be able to produce greater force at longer lengths and at higher speeds. Okay, so we know that those architectural adaptations will facilitate my ability to generate, and I would argue to tolerate, forces at those lengths, which are the same positions, we could argue as well, where muscle is at risk of injury. So what are the consequences of injury? Whenever we see an injury, and many of us be familiar with Jarvinen's paper from American Journal of Sports Medicine in 05, and the time course here, and you know, this is sort of kindergarten stuff compared to the images that Abigail have just shown, so I'm going to quickly move past that. But we know that the effects of unloading as well are pretty much as in addition to what we've seen as the effects of injury that have been really well explained by Abigail. Then we know that if I have a muscle that has been injured, that muscle will be unloaded and I will see some other effects. And we know this is physiology 101, isn't it? And we get a reduction in cross-sectional area of the muscle, with reduction in strength, we see changes in pination or angle or fascicle angle, if you prefer, in fascicle length, and we see all of these changes. Really nice study by Amy Silder and groups and the group there in the States looked at people who had a hamstring injury and MRI findings. And what you see here in the right limb on the left-hand side of the screen versus the left, you'll see the biceps femoris. And what you see here in the injured limb, you'll see the atrophy of the biceps femoris long head compared to the uninjured size. But what you see is a corresponding, if you like, hypertrophy of the short head. So if you like a compensatory adaptation in the short head of biceps femoris as a consequence. So we have clear MRI evidence that atrophy is an issue following injury. So I would suggest, is that effective healing? Is effective healing a reduction in the size of the muscle? So we see this, and that's something that I think in our exercise prescription we need to counteract. Similarly, we in the same study they reported, here we have this marbled effect within the biceps femoris long head, again with that fatty infiltration. And again, if we get fatty infiltration with muscles, we see it not only in biceps, we see it around the shoulder, we see it in other chronic muscle tears. It reduces and really compromises the capacity of that muscle to heal. So limiting fatty infiltration and maximizing healing is particularly important. So we know that muscle injury has important structural effects and that these will have an impact on our function. But it's not just the structural effects. What we know is there's many neuromuscular effects of injury. And here, Gisela Sowell has shown that in previously injured hamstrings, you get a reduction in the ability to generate force at those longer lengths. Similarly, we see changes in the EMG onset time between where we have a transition from double to single leg standing. And here you see the hamstring group, the injured side here versus the uninjured side. And we see that early activation of the hamstring muscle, suggesting that there are changes in the sequencing and timing of the hamstring muscle from within that intramuscular coordination. So we see changes of the ability to generate force. We see changes of coordination. And then Eric's group from Schurman's that he may talk to afterwards here is that we see changes in intermuscular fatigue pattern between the hamstring groups. So we see biceps femoris, semitendinosus membranosus, and what we see here in the injury group, we see an increased loading of the biceps femoris with a increased activity of the biceps femoris with a reduction in activity share of semitendinosus. And similarly, we see an increase in the relaxation time of the muscle here, which is the amount of metabolic activity following injury. Similarly, in a subsequent study, we see changes in glute activation patterns. So what I would suggest is that there are intermuscular and intramuscular changes at a neuromuscular level. So we see structural components and neuromuscular components. And I would contend, therefore, that our rehabilitation has to address these two key things. So our goal of loading needs to address that. But the other thing that we have to take into account is that we're dealing with human beings. And human beings experience pain, and muscle tears are painful. And often people will come to us and pain will be one of their primary symptoms. So we've got to do something with our exercise prescription to address pain. And that may be some of the nociceptive input coming from the tissue damage locally or other factors, contextual factors. We want to increase our tissue capacity with the structure and our movement capability. So when do we start that? When does our rehab begin? Well, most of the studies that we see in hamstring rehabilitation tends to begin at around 5 days, or the earliest it begins is at around 5 days post-injury. Now, what happens in the real world? Well, I'm fortunate enough to work in high-performance sport, and rehabilitation begins immediately. The person is injured, and we manage it from day zero, from moment zero, and right through. So I would suggest that delaying things for 5 days probably doesn't reflect what happens in the real world. Perhaps some recreational athletes, when they want to seek some extra input, it may reflect that, but certainly not high-performance sport. But one thing that I would suggest, if we want to maximise healing, is that optimal loading in terms of rehabilitation, optimal loading is early loading, and the earlier we load a muscle, I would suggest that the better the healing will be and the better the outcomes. And so if we go back to our kindergarten representation, apologies Abigail, but here these are the days, but at day two we see that hematoma, we see the macrophages are getting to work, we see the mechanical block between the injured ends of the muscle, if you like, and how this progresses over time to provide an effective scaffold and the fibroblastic activity to then provide a muscle that is relatively well healed at about the 3 week period in that 21 days. So there is a time course. Now, can we influence the quality of that healing and factors of that healing? Well, Jarvinen showed in this animal model, and this is a contusion type injury, where there was an active mobilization, where there was free mobilization of the animals and free immobilization in a cage, there's an oxymoron, and immobilization. And so the capillary, what we see is better intensive ingrowth of new capillaries towards this avascular center in the mobilization group, whereas if we compare that to the immobilization group, what you see is this large hematoma and this large avascular region. So it appears that early mobilization will be a good stimulus for recapillarization, which we all know is important part of healing. In a subsequent study, the same group looked at a comparison between an immobilization and a mobilization group, where the immobilization group was immobilized for 2 days, which again is what it is, and the immobilization group for 21 days. So we won't get caught in the semantics of the 2 days and 21 days because it doesn't reflect, if you like, what happens clinically. But what we'll see here particularly is this is the mobilization group and the immobilization group and the strength of the tissue. And what you see is that for as long as the immobilization group was immobilized, there was no change in strength. So what you see is that only once the mobilization was commenced did we start to see an increase in strength, and that increase in strength increased linearly over time. I think the key point that I would take from that is that there was no regeneration of strength with immobilization. So the earlier we get moving, the more capacity and potential, pardon me, potential there is for regeneration. There is this study done by the guys in Copenhagen. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in September past, where they looked at early versus delayed rehabilitation after acute muscle injury. And what we see here is the patient recovery time, and they began in terms of percentage. The earliest return to sport was 30 days, and I would suggest by high performance sports standards that's pretty slow. That's at least twice as long as I would want to see. And that increased right along here. But we see consistently the delayed therapy group was lagged about 3 weeks behind. And now what we see is that the early group started at 2 days post-injury, whereas the delayed group started at 9 days post-injury, so a 1 week delay. So it would suggest that a 1 week delay in starting rehabilitation results perhaps in a 3 week delay in return to sport. And you see this median. So what did they do in their rehabilitation? Well, they had four phases, and in phase one, they did stretching. Phase two, there were some isometrics, which they did through increasing muscle length, and they permitted pain less than 5 out of 10. That was weeks 2 to 4. In phase 3 after that, there was dynamic resistance, where they worked at relatively light weights of 15 RM times 3 a week. And then at week 8, they began increasing the load to 5 to 10 RM, slow movements through full range. And then after that, usually at about weeks 9 onwards, they did 8 to 9, they did heavy slow resistance training with an ECSS focus and some functional drills. I would suggest that I don't know anyone working high performance sports that does this, okay, in week one. In fact, I would suggest this is where I start on day two, but this was being introduced probably by about week eight. So I think that it's a fantastic study with great clear outcomes, but I'm not sure that the rehabilitation program that they describe actually reflects what often happens in clinical practice. So what do we do? And what was interesting, however, I think the take home here is that a 1 week delay in starting rehab corresponded to about a 3 week delay in return to sport. And again, out in Qatar, where Eric had been previous to being in Belgium now, in this study by Jacobson and BJSM, showed that for every day there was a delay in the start of rehabilitation, it corresponded to about a 3 day delay in return to sport. So I would suggest that optimal loading is early loading, and that by loading the tissue early, we see this better capillary ingrowth, better regeneration, more parallel orientation, and all of these factors that we're very familiar with. So we've got to get in early. So what do we do when we get in early, and what are we trying to achieve? Well, if we want to improve, we're perhaps increasing things like fascicle length, physiological cross-section area. We're changing perhaps all the things like collagen isoforms and the tissue, those non-contractile components. And then are we doing something about the overall stiffness of the muscle tendon unit? Well, can we influence muscle architecture, and how do we do that? Well, how do we do it in normal training? Well, we do it very well with most of our performance training all the time. We prescribe exercise to increase or change pination angle, to change fascicle length, to change physiological cross-section area. And I would contend that we just use exactly the same principles, and that rehabilitation is actually training in the presence of injury, and we have to be cognizant of the healing and the rate and the timing of healing. The key contraction variables I would suggest in our exercise prescription in rehabilitation are these shown on the screen. And we'll look at a couple of these, particularly contraction mode and velocity at the moment, and joint dominance. And I have to acknowledge Dave Opar for providing me with the next two slides. So Ryan Timmons had done a nice study published a couple of years ago looking at fascicle length and its response to different types of exercise in the biceps femoris long head. And what we see, this group was the eccentric training group, this group was the concentric training group, and what we see over time, here, as you see, after 42 days of training, a 14% increase in fascicle length of the biceps femoris long head. Correspondingly, for the concentric only group, there was a reduction, a 13% reduction in fascicle length. So what this study suggests is that, and again, we saw it yesterday, it's perhaps not as clear a picture as this might suggest, but that eccentric training seems to be a very strong stimulus for increasing fascicle length and for getting more sarcomeres in series. And we've known that from many of the exercise-induced muscle damage and DOM studies from historically that have been done many years ago. What was interesting in this study as well, however, is that whenever whenever they stop the eccentric training, you see a regression back towards baseline here within 4 weeks. So within 4 weeks, the adaptation that was achieved was pretty much lost from the eccentrics, whereas there appears to still have been a reduced fascicle length for those who just did concentrics. Okay, so eccentrics seem to be important, and anyone here in the room who knows about injury prevention and certainly and rehabilitation and re-injury, we see that eccentric contractions are particularly important in injury prevention of muscle, in muscle injury prevention. If we look then at particular which exercise, so if we want to think about the hamstring, do we focus on the knee moment or the hip moment? I would contend you look at both, but again, Matt Bourne here looking at biceps fascicle length again, and comparing the Nordic hamstring exercise with the hip extension at 45 degrees. What we see here is the control group, where there was essentially no change in fascicle length. We see the Nordic group, where there was, after 5 weeks training, about a 12% increase, and then after 10 weeks, a 21% increase in fascicle length. For the hip extension exercise, there was a 7.4% after 5 weeks, up to 12.5% almost after 10 weeks. The obvious difference between this, which again isn't, I think, emphasized in this paper so much, is that this is an eccentric only exercise and this is a concentric and eccentric exercise. So we're comparing apples and oranges here. But what I would suggest, where there is an eccentric only exercise, we tend to get a greater change in fascicle length. Where we have a combination of concentric and eccentric, we still get the adaptation, but it's not as great. But I would still argue that you need to train the hamstring through both hip and knee dominant actions. So it's not just about the if you like, the eccentric and the rib, but it's perhaps, I think, the lengthening velocity. And this just was an interesting study that I wanted to highlight, where they looked at different protocols of low and high magnitude at different lengths and at different velocities. And ultimately, when we looked at the fascicle lengthening, there was no real significant change over time. Over time throughout the exercise at different parts of that eccentric component. So that's sort of, if you like, the inner, middle, outer range of the eccentric, and this is for vastus lateralis. What we see, however, is that the shortening, or the lengthening velocity, pardon me, in the high velocity exercise was particularly different. And so just the amount of load you apply, whether it's high load or low load, and perhaps even the range, you cannot predict what's happening at the fascicle kinetics. But what we are seeing is that certainly the high velocity tended to get changes, greater changes in fascicle length. So perhaps the velocity, and I would suggest that actually the high velocity, the individual subjects almost lost control of the movement, and it was end range, so there's that loss of control, so you were producing really high forces, and I would suggest that potentially that high speed lengthening at the end was stimulating some signaling within the muscle to change its fascicle length. And so getting eccentrics seems to be important, and I would argue that you need to do them very early. And I would suggest that early eccentrics perhaps aren't as dangerous as you might think, because what we saw from the last study was we were doing high velocity lengthening, so we were getting mechanical changes here. But actually, most of the early eccentrics we do tend to stay down at low velocity. And I would argue that perhaps if we're working in that range, because most of the concentric sits in this range, that the forces that we're putting through the muscle perhaps aren't that bad after all. And that actually it's the neuromuscular patterning of that is more important in maintaining that eccentric control. So if we can find a way to apply eccentric load in a safe and a controlled manner, we'll get a pretty good outcome. And so I would suggest at this end of the eccentric relationship, it's more mechanical changes, or architectural changes. At this end is perhaps neuromuscular changes. So when do we start eccentric loading? Well, for a good few years now, we've been doing things like introducing a leg slide when they can do bilaterally on day two. So get people doing this on day two. They can support it with their unaffected leg, and you put as much weight through your right leg as you can. Progress to unilateral. I also think that one of the other things we've been doing for a very long time is getting people to do controlled eccentric lengthening in this position, and starting off at 90 degrees hip flexion and working up to maximum hip flexion, where we're working eccentric lengthening. We can use low levels of resistance, and we've seen pretty good effects, I think, and responses to that. Jack Hickey in our group, working with Dave Opar again, has since produced this program, which I'll swing through super quick, where we begin working bilaterally on these exercises, where these are concentric, eccentric, and then this is an eccentric bias. Once they can complete full range bilaterally, they move to unilateral, and once they can do that bilaterally, they also start to introduce Nordic hamstring curls. The outcomes from that study are particularly nice in the sense of that they get very good outcomes in terms of recurrence rate, not return to sport times, but recurrence rates, and actually we don't see that concurrent increase in pain. Because one of the factors that people suggest, don't do eccentrics because they might be painful and you might cause damage. Well, how does pain influence our progression? Well, if we're trying to prescribe exercise to help pain, it's obvious we want to see that pain reduce. I would suggest if you're prescribing exercises to change structural components, I'm happy to tolerate a 3 to 4 out of 10 pain. Okay, which was the level of pain that was happy here. If, however, my goal is to improve movement capability and movement quality, I want to ensure that the pain, is absolutely minimal. So I want to keep that really down as low as I possibly can. Okay, so some of the factors that we've disclosed there, I'm going to hop right through to a summary slide if we can, because time's gone. But what I'd say is the introduction, I was going to just mention quickly about the importance of doing high-speed running early, and that's another talk for another day, because Belgium start very soon, Eric. Okay, so if we're thinking about how we would prescribe to facilitate some of these things, what type of exercises? Well, we're trying to induce analgesia, and in tissue capacity, we want to change morphology. What key things? Fascial length, physiological cross-sectional area, pination angle, perhaps muscle tendon unit stiffness in terms of collagen reorganization. Movement capability, we want to change strength and its sub-parameters, as well as some of these other factors. How do we do that? And how does that maximize healing? Well, I would suggest for pain, get people moving. Just get them moving. Dynamic movement through range, as much as they can, and you will see a reduction in their pain. Do not immobilize them, and don't get them to, especially don't get them to contract isometrically because it hurts. For tissue capacity, our emphasis is on eccentric. Think about the direction, the length, and the joint moments, and start early if you can. For movement capability, what I'm saying is that also to restore that neuromuscular capacity, we need to do neuromuscular control training. And this will include specific strength training, high-speed running, as well as lumbopelvic control and the ability to adapt. And in preparation for Eric's presentation, when's the athlete ready to return to play? When are they healed? Well, it depends really if we're talking about tissue healing or function. I look at this at different time and it takes to boil an egg. When's the egg ready? The ultimate question is, well, how do you like your eggs? Yeah. So when's the person ready to return to sport? How much risk are you willing to tolerate? Do you want full healing or do you want tissue healing or do you want full function? That's the question. Thank you very much. Thank you.